sinni enn.
Þrái
allt sem vonin biður einu sinni enn, svo ekki neitt meira.
Ég veit að verður erfitt fyrir mig að skilja við hann. Þetta svona eins og að sjá eftir einum úr fjölskyldunni. Og en við búum bara við þau skilirði núna að það ekkert annað í myndinni. Það segja ef maður ætlar að keppa á heimsmeistaramóti.
Einu sinni enn, ekkert á morgun, ekki heldur neitt sem var. Einu sinni enn, meðan augun þín brosa.
Það er einlega ótrúlegt að sú hugsun komi upp og arða þess virði.
Actually, wanted to talk about this film because it's a very good example of a good story. And I wanted to mention a few things that I have learned especially from making this film. When I got permission from this guy to document this, I knew I had a good story, but it developed the best possible way because he won. And everybody I told this idea or this story, they understood the plot in the story. You didn't need to be a horseman or to practice horsemanship to understand it. So it was indeed easy to find too. So number one is a good story to tell. The second thing I kept in mind was to work to hire the best cameramen and the best, let's say, good cameraman and a good editor. I didn't try to do it myself. I just hired the best people I knew to do it. And the outcome was fine. The Icelandic State TV bought the film. And what is most important, there were a lot of festivals who wanted to show it. And that's the third key point I wanted to deliver to you from my experience, is to concentrate on film festivals, try to pick out festivals which suits your style or suits your goals in your filmmaking. Because actually, I got the film funded from the Icelandic Film Center. I sold, I think, 5,000 DVDs. Now I went to a film festival in Lübeck last year. I was screening another film there, but I of course I took a part in the parties at night, but I always woke up early to meet the guys from the TV station in the breakfast. That's a very, very important thing if you want to, if you want to get contacts. It's very good to use the breakfast time because everybody is, somebody has a hangover, but everybody's okay in their head, and it's good atmosphere to do business. So I gave him my DVDs, and NDR, the North German TV, they have bought it now, and they want to show it a part of it or the whole film. So when you want to deliver things and make possibilities to make new projects, the film festivals are key things. Yeah.
To get contacts, that's what you mean, like, you know.
Pardon?
You say that film festivals are key to, like, you know, get contacts.
To get contacts. It's also very important for the film center that your film is traveling a little bit around the world. I think Kraftwerk went to 9 festivals. It's very important for you when you apply for some money to do the next project to have this track record, and it's also very important to. If it is a possibility to sell it in TV abroad.
Can I ask you?
Yes.
I've heard that, I don't know if I'm right, but I've heard that here in Iceland, you can basically almost do like a bachelor on a topic of training the race horses. Is it true? Like it's actually a thing that you can study it and get a degree in it.
Pardon me?
I've heard that here in Iceland,
yep.
You can do like an actual bachelor, for example, on a topic of training race horses. Like you can study it.
Yes, it's true.
And here in the movie, as I've understood, it's like a little bit of conflict in between those who just studied and in between those who've been, you know, doing that since childhood, right? Or no?
Yes and no. It's indeed the University of the Icelandic Horse is located here in Skagafjörður. But those are two different worlds, actually, the racing and enjoying those. And they don't actually have very much to do with each other. But this film wasn't about racing, actually. It was about how to enjoy the horse. And of course, the racing people, they know how to enjoy nature and enjoy horseback riding.
Mm-hmm.
This was more to show that you have to sacrifice the beauty for the money, actually. So yeah, it's in a way it's right.
Alan, yeah. Just to clarify, I'm sorry if I didn't catch it at the beginning.
Pardon?
I'm sorry if I didn't catch it at the beginning, but the sacrifice was that once he participated in that race outside of Iceland, he can never bring his horse back to Iceland.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's because the horse has been isolated for 1100 years.
So once he gets the horse out, everyone who goes to competition, the horses can never come back.
Can never come back. And what happened with the horse? He was sold. Actually, I just ended the film there, and I left this question open: was it all worth it? But the truth is, he sold it to two young girls in Sweden. Usually, they sell these famous horses for a lot of money, but he decided to sell them the horse. On condition that he was allowed to come over the ride the horse and keep the contact, but it wasn't the same. It was It has never been the same.
And now a question, how much money you got from the TV station?
Oh, I got, somebody can, I got
Iceland?
1.5 million from Icelandic crowns.
Is it like
8,000
euros?
Yeah.
Well, no, it's like
10,000
euros.
Yes, 10,000.
But I got 8 million from the Icelandic Film Center. And, I suppose I got 5 or 6 million from the DVDs.
And from Germany?
I don't know, I'm still negotiating with them. But it's not a lot of money, maybe 500,000 or 1 million crowns, something like that.
So for funding you got 8 million from the center and 1.8 from who?
From Roof.
From Roof, yeah. Okay.
And where do you send your DVDs?
I say it's 95% on the internet, and also in Leicester, what is it called, Elko, in the shop.
So most of the sales is through like video on demand. What?
No, I haven't.
So you sold it on the internet, the DVDs itself?
Yeah, I sold it on, it's sort of sale on internet bookshops and so on. And it's still selling. And it has a Facebook, it has 5,000 followers on Facebook.
Did you advertise
somehow? Sorry?
Did you advertise?
No, actually not. Just it advertised itself. I'm not very good in advertising and doing that stuff.
Because by now a lot of people, so they should know from somewhere about the film.
Yeah, so it's you can say generally in this this horsemanship world, you have 20% which are racing. In a some way, they're doing it as a sport, but the 80% they're doing it for the fun of it and the passion. And it's actually that group that has bought it, that group that is on Facebook. 70% woman, and you can say it's a mother and a group.
Yeah.
When
was it shot?
When
was the movie shot?
It was in 2007. And then we took 2 years to on editing it, and it was we were three together. And we had one advisor from the film center, and we disagreed very much. But in the end, I managed to do it the way I wanted to do it. So I'm just happy about that.
Can you tell us how you did the marketing for this film?
Marketing?
Yeah. Did you?
I didn't do any marketing.
No. Okay.
No. Actually, it happens. When I sold it to the TV, they said we need some trailers for advertising in our TV channel. So I gave them the trailers and I put it on YouTube. And I think the trailer has now 46,000 views or something.
Okay.
So it's just the internet.
And where was it premiered? Where was it premiered? Was it premiered on TV or, you know, in a cinema?
Both.
Both.
Okay. Yeah.
So premiered in Iceland in a cinema.
Yes, it was shot on a very good cameras. So it was we were able to screen it in big cinemas. I think I got 3,000 people or something like that.
So it was a very nice thing, but number one, if you have a good story, go for it. That's number one, and number two, work with professional people. And number three, use this film festivals and use it for building up a network. And, yeah, and sell your tickets. And you?
Yeah, also, how many people were actually working during the shooting? It was you, one cameraman?
Two cameramen.
Two cameramen.
And me, actually, we were three.
And the sound?
It was a expensive lesson. You mentioned it yesterday, that you didn't afford to have bad microphones. Yes, I learned my lesson because it was much more expensive to fix the sound afterwards. It was I spent millions on it. So I should have
spent on sound.
So like the most you were shooting with two cameras mostly at the same time or during the race you were also.
Yeah.
Was two.
Out in the nature, we were shooting with one camera, but in Holland, we were shooting with two cameras. And of course, we had problems with the World Championship and people there, because there was a TV station, which had a monopoly to film it. It's just like always, when you are doing a documentary, you have to push to get there. Yeah.
Where did you have an international premiere? In what festival, if you remember?
National premiere.
International.
It was in Thessalonica. In
Thessaloniki.
In Greece.
In Greece.
Thessaloniki.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It was almost at the same time in Canada too, in a small festival there. And usually people, it's usually that people in the end they cry a little bit because it's a really sad story. But in Canada, there were an old lady, 19 years old, and she started to cry. When the sun went down, and we were showing this landscape, and I asked her why were you crying at this point? This wasn't the right point to cry. So he said, my parents, they came from Iceland, and I've never been there myself, but they explained it for me how beautiful it was. And that's why she started.
What cameras do you use?
It was this big Sony HD with a tape, with big tapes, 6 or 7 minutes. The thing is, I've been working on feature films. We were working a lot on Of Horses and Men. And actually, I play a very little role in the film because it was a low budget thing that they needed to just pick up an actor from the street. But no, I just like to. If you are doing a documentary, you can decide the whole thing yourself. And I like that. And it's just the answer. It's just because I like it.
Maybe you like true stories.
Yeah, it's all about storytelling. I mean, filmmaking is just storytelling. Mm-hmm.
And maybe you know what was the budget of the horse?
It was, they didn't manage to finance it beforehand. And I think they had 80 million Icelandic crowns or something.
80.
You're 75 from 80, 90 million.
So it's quite okay.
Yeah.
That is 533 euros.
Thousand
euros.
500 euros.
The Kronas have really been bad. It was very, very low budget.
Yeah. We were sleeping all together in on the floor, and it was a hard work. It was a lot of fun. Unusual film because we were filming outside most of the time. Out in nature, so yeah.
In between, everybody liked the film very important.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was. We had it in the festival, and it was crowded every screening. You can't get any ticket.
Set
horses.
In what festival was it screening?
Skanderborg.
This one.
one of the cameramen.
This one we are now.
One of the cameramen in this film was a cinema photographer or director of Horses and Men. So I need to go now. So I will say goodbye to you here. Hopefully I can join you tomorrow, because I need to be a Reykjavik tomorrow, and when I have a spare time, I hopefully can meet you to say goodbye. But if you have any questions, I can answer it. If not,
on phone.
On phone. If not, I just thank you very much for coming. It's been nice to meet you.